architectural wood remains from northwestern Alaska. I'll leave you the floor, Juliette, for this presentation. Thank you.
So, hello to all. I would like first to thank the organizer of this symposium. My name is Juliette Tailleb. I am a PhD candidate in archaeology at Panthéon-Sorbonne University in Paris. Today, I present the preliminary dendroarchaeological result obtained as part of my PhD research, which focuses on the climate analysis of architectural wood remains from the last 1,000 years in Northwest Alaska. My goal is to revisit the climatic framework of the transition of the medieval climate anomaly to the Little Ice Age, a period of major cultural transformation in the region. Northwest Alaska is a key region for understanding settlement dynamics of the beginning of the second millennium AD in the American Arctic. During the medieval climate anomaly, 10th to 13th centuries AD, and then the transition towards the Little Ice Age, 13th to 15th centuries AD, the Thule culture, considered as a direct ancestor of today's Inuit, appears along the coast of northwestern Alaska. The subsistence economy of these early Thule groups is focused on marine resources as seal and possibly whales. Thule groups settle in semi-subterranean houses built of a frame of food, as you can see on the picture on the right, sometimes whalebone, and covered with sod. Wood resources were omnipresent in Thule daily life, particularly for architectures and daily equipment. In the 13th centuries, Thule groups start entering interior northwest Alaska, settling along the Kobuk River right there, and eventually expanding east all the way to Greenland. Along the treeless coast of northern Alaska, timber used by human groups come from driftwood piles. These wood logs originate in the subarctic interior boreal forest from Alaska and are carried by major rivers and sea currents to beaches where they end up stranded. Early pioneer research in dendrochronology using archaeological wood started as early as the 40s in Alaska. However, it was mostly abandoned in the 50s when radiocarbon dating became available, offering broader dating applicability in a wood-lacking site. As a result, today there is only one 1,000-year-old tree-ring chronology, which was built in the 40s, from the Kobuk River Valley wood samples that you can see right there. Since then, dendroclimatologists updated the chronology to 2002. However, the early part of the sequence remained represented by a low number of samples, four before AD 1100. Yet, this millenary tree-ring chronology is essential because the MCA-NEA transition is poorly characterized in the region. So most of MCA-NEA transition climate data for northwestern Alaska is inferred from extra-regional records, as you can see on the map. As a result, the chronology and magnitude of the climatic variation of this time period are not well defined. The poor resolution of regional environmental indicators that characterize the MCA-NEA transition is a limit to detailed temporal and spatial analysis of the complex interaction between climate, resources, and people. Additional tree-ring samples are needed to improve the early part of this Kobuk River millenary sequence and enable local reconstruction with finer temporal and spatial scales. Since the 40s, only a handful of researchers collected well-preserved wood discs from coastal archaeological Thule sites dating to the last 1,000 years or earlier. Analyzing this disc using traditional tree-ring techniques and more recent techniques, such as dendroisotopy and wiggle matching dating, should allow us to expand and develop high-resolution tree-ring master chronology and climate sequences in northwestern Alaska. The goal is to renew the climatic documentation on this pivotal period that sees the development of Inuit culture. In my paper today, I present a work that allow increasing the number of disks contributing to the early part of the Kobuk River master chronology using conventional ring-width analysis of archaeological spruce sample. And I discuss the climate data we can expect to obtain from this renewed robust record. We analyze a set of 283 archaeological wood disks of white spruce Picea glauca, a species sensitive to summer temperature variation, where spruce goes along river, floodplain, and valley bottom, and therefore it is a frequent species in driftwood piles adjacent to today's coastal site. The analyzed disc samples are from architectural wood elements from several sites. First, two winter houses from the whaling village of Pingusuguruk at Point Franklin, that you can see over there, which is radiocarbon dated between the 14th to 17th centuries. B, two house mounds from the Birnik type site near Point Barrow, with occupation thought to be around the 11th to 13th century at the top. C, five semi-subterranean houses from three sites at Cape Espenberg, Seward Peninsula, with a specific focus on Feature 12 and Feature 21, radiocarbon dating between the 10th to the 13th century. You can see the points right there, it's the C. And finally, several houses from three sites excavated and sampled in the 40s by Alaska archaeologist James Lee Giddings. These three sites, named Exhibit, Intermediate and Old Côte d'Ébut, are located respectively on the Kobuk River, right there, on the Kobuk Rivers, and at the tip of the Baldwin Peninsula in Côte d'Ébut Sound. Several of these legacy wood samples were never processed and analyzed previously. This potential for dendrochronological analysis was assessed using several criteria, such as species identification, preservation, and length of the cross ring series, with a minimum of 70 rings. Selected discs were prepared and ring width measured using standard procedure. Conventional dendrochronology relies on the study of ring width variation. Each tree has its own unique pattern of growth, but also share common characteristics such as years showing particularly wide or narrow rings with other trees within a given region. In Alaska, it is possible to distinguish various regional and subregional signatures following a longitudinal gradient from the tree line to the interior forest. Row ring width theory was then cross-dated for each house and then each site, allowing us to identify architectural wood discs with similar ring width patterns and to synchronize them into mean floating sequence. We determined positive tree ring cross-dating based on statistical indices and visual comparison, which are commonly used in dendrochronology. We use the software TSAPWIN and the CDI cross-date index as our main statistical index. Statistical thresholds were set up in agreement with the literature and tests performed with the individual series of the existing Kobuk chronology. These floating sequences and the individual series were then cross-dated with the Kobuk River Master Tree Ring Chronology, the only existing sequence in Alaska, long enough to allow cross-dating of archaeological wood from Northwest Alaska to the site, allowing eventually to date them and determine if the disc came from Northwestern Alaska. Our analysis of the disc shows that in all sites, discs have an average segment length of 119 rings, with a minimum of 70 rings and a maximum of 390 rings, and are for mature tree. Among these 283 discs, 72 are from the Three Kobuk River site and 217 are from the Three Coastal site, as you can see on the graphic. 44 discs from Exhibit and Côte d'Ébut site were cross-dated with the Kobuk River Master Chronology. Each individual tree-ring series was added to the Master Chronology, which represents 20 new samples for the period of AD 1000 to 1250, 15 samples from 1250 to 1450, and 9 samples from 1450 to 1950. From the coastal site wood disc, we were able to build 5 highly cross-dated floating sequences. One sequence from the Pingusuguruk site made of 4 discs, the first one, and 2 sequences from Cape Espenberg made of 4 samples each, as you can see in the 2 other graphics. We were also able to build 1 particularly robust sequence from House Feature 12 at Cape Espenberg, made of 16 discs, and 1 sequence from both Pingusuguruk and Cape Espenberg sample made of 10 discs. Six additional isolated mean floating sequences composed of two to three samples each were also built. The number of unrelated floating chronology is due to the multiple origin of coastal driftwood. We then cross-dated these floating tree-ring sequences and individual tree-ring series with the Kobuk River master chronology, to which were added the cross-dated Exavik and Kotzebue disk. 23 individual series cross-dated positively with the Kobuk master sequence, representing two of the floating sequences, one made of four disks from Pigou-Sungurud, and the sequence made of 16 disks from Cape Espenberg, and also representing three additional isolated individual series from Cape Espenberg. The positive cross-dating of this 16, as you can see here, of this 16 disk sequence with the Kobuk master chronology enabled to extend her back in time from AD 978 to AD 812. This successful cross-dating reinforced the Kobuk chronology of 17 new samples for AD 800 to 1250. Five samples that you can see right there, five samples for 1400 to 1620, and one sample for 1650 to 1758. Nine floating tree-ring sequences did not cross-date with the Kobuk River master chronology and remain undated. We know from Giddings and previous work on the origin of driftwood in Alaska that a large part of it comes from the interior Alaska by way of the Yukon River, as you can see right there, the Yukon River's northwest Alaska and the sequence. Existing tree-ring master sequences from interior Alaska only have a time depth of 200 to 300 years, showing varying signature along a longitudinal gradient. This most likely explains why many of the floating chronology remain undated. Some of these disks are subject to ongoing radiocarbon dating today and wiggle matching approach that will place them in calendar time. In the end, it is a total of 67 archaeological disks, both from the Kobuk River and coastal site, that we cross-date with the Kobuk River master chronology. This represents 23% of the disk, as you can see on the graphic. Will another 11% cross-date together, but are not dated. 52 of the 67 disks contribute to the early part of the Kobuk River chronology, between AD 812 and AD 1450, as you can see on the graphic. The Kobuk chronology goes back to AD 812, and the period between 980 and 1250, as you can see there, is now made of 60 trees. The next period, the transition to the Little Ice Age, is represented by 65 individual trees. A walk allowed to double the number of individual trees contributing to the MCA-LEA transition. This provides us now with a unique and local sequence to document and analyze the climatic variation of this time period. We also reinforce the number of trees contributing to the period of AD 1450 to 1650, the peak of LEA, with 15 additional architectural wood remains. The 16th and 17th century represent the most severe period of the Little Ice Age, which was also a period of cultural regionalization of the Tulik groups in the Kobuk River Valley and northwestern Alaska. The robustness of this renewed Kobuk chronology based on Roaring-Wise data was evaluated with common statistics in dendrochronology as a mean intertree correlation and the express population signal. The express population signal is a key statistic in dendrochronology, which allows to evaluate how well a given number of series represents an infinite population chronology. The original Kobuk sequence appeared previously as representative from around AD 1100, with a minimum of six trees. Today, the augmented Kobuk sequence appears as reliable from AD 974, documenting the medieval climate anomaly and allowing to discuss the growth and climatic trends previously observed in the region with a smaller set of samples, as you can see right there and there on the graphic. These architectural timbers are today the subject of an ongoing dendroclimatic study, which combine conventional ring wave analysis and more innovative geochemistry analysis of carbon and oxygen isotopes in wood cellulose. The conventional dendroclimatic interpretation of the growth spectra ring waves allow to determine, according to standard method of data standardization and calibration, the favorable or unfavorable response of trees to temperature variation. Temperature is the main climatic parameter which controls the growth of spruce trees in Alaska. The geochemical analysis of the annual isotopic composition of oxygen and carbon is conducted on five archaeological timber from structure 12 of Cape Espendel that are studied year per year over a common period of 70 years, from AD 1050 to 1120. As you can see on the graphic on the right, this ongoing analysis will provide information in terms of temperature and humidity for the MCA at a period where geomorphological studies indicate severe storms along the coast of northwestern Alaska, while isotopic composition also have an annual resolution and a regional character. They are not determined by the sensitivity of the tree to the climate and by the age effect specific to the tree. Dendroisotopy is then a complementary tool to test and verify the accuracy of the information obtained from ring waves. This multiscalar reconstruction of climatic variation at local, regional, and transregional scale will be compared to known environmental proxy for the region, including annual lake sediment and storm cycle sequence. This Kobuk renewed sequence for Northwest Alaska, based on architectural wood remains, will allow us to establish a solid paleo-environmental context in Northwest Alaska and to question the interaction between two lake groups and their environment at a key moment in the development of Inuit cultures. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much. That was lovely. That was really, really impressive. Such an amount of work. That's really great. From the chat, I don't see any question. Do we have a question from the audience?
Oh, stop sharing. Sorry.
I've got. There's a question from Xavier Deglise. How are you collecting samples yourself in Alaska?
So there is a project called Cape Espendel Bean Project conducted by archaeologists Claire Alex and Owen Mason in 2016 and 2017 that allow us to collect architectural wood from Cape Espendel to lay sites. And for the other collection, it's from an older archaeological project from the 1550s and from the 1990s.
Okay, thank you. We've got a comment. It's saying it's a very, very difficult presentation indeed, madam. So everybody's underlying this really nice and precise amount of work. It's really nice. I was just wondering,
Yes.
Yeah. It's there no other species found, or were they discarded from the sampling?
They were discarded mainly because we work only with one species to be certain that the climatic variation records record the same way for each sample.
Yeah.
Because it's dependent of species. So yeah. To be certain, we work with only one species.
Yeah, to avoid problems. Yeah. Well, thank you very much again. Lovely work. All the best for the rest of you for the end of your PhD. And I hope you will enjoy having a new network through this audience. Use it without any problem. Thank you very much. Thank you.